Hello and a very warm welcome to the late April garden tour of this permaculture no-dig kitchen garden. The garden always starts in this area where we start off all the seedlings. For the last month or two, it's been a constant production of all sorts coming through. One thing I'm excited about is this Chinese garlic chives, which I got from Real Seeds. Apparently, they create a tuber and grow back every year. I'm excited to see those. One of the other things that we've just planted is mangel beets or mangel wurzel. Because of Steph Hafferty and seeing how amazing that looks, and apparently it makes a good wine, we thought, let's try it this year. But yeah, as always, constant production line, a lot of things growing on. This looks like a daisy and it's related, it's in the same family. It's actually chop suey greens, which it's beautiful flowers and it's absolutely stunning. And there's a lot of bee activity happening here in the solar tunnel with everything else that's flowering. But this, you can actually eat the beautiful flower petals, which I had no idea, but honestly, grow some chop suey greens and let them flower because this is stunning. I'm going to do something I've been wanting to do ever since I've seen one of James Pagioni's recent videos where he harvested his asparagus and ate it raw. And I've never actually done this before. It's actually the first season it's going to come through to eat. So I'm going to try raw asparagus for the first time. Oh, that tastes like peas actually. It's amazing. And Charlie's giggling in the background because of my reaction. That just tastes like asparagus and peas had a baby. It's delicious. This bed that I'm sat on, the front of it is where we're doing a seedling bed of leeks. We've got five different varieties all sown, so that's going to be a big part of this year's garden. But I want to draw your attention to this. This is using the recent flop phenomenon, which we've discovered that brassicas like to do. If they seem to flop over, they seem to send up a lot more flower shoots. This is actually red cabbage that has then kind of gone to seed. And this stem, or the flower stem, is honestly, it's one of the most delicious things that I've tasted from a brassica family. So if you've got some red cabbage and it does the cabbage flop, or the brassica flop phenomenon, try some of the stem. It was really good. Sam was thinking perhaps a kimchi. In front of me, we've got the first strawberry flowers appearing, which is always a lovely sight. And this bed last year was actually the brassica seed bed. As you know, I like to start them off and then transplant them out into their final positions. I'm actually going to be using it for a brassica seed bed again this year. However, at the top end, I've planted or transplanted some rat's tail radish. It's a variety I got from Baker Creek Seeds. It looks really fascinating. And basically, it's really long, thin purple seed pods, and I can't wait to see how that turns out. And I'm also really excited for some more globe artichokes because these were so delicious last year. This is one of my favorite parts of the garden because it's a nice border for flowers and herbs and some spare seedlings. I've got calendula, coriander, lilies coming through, elephant garlic, a bit of comfrey. And actually, yesterday I was filming a bit for Gardena, where we're working together this year and really trying to focus on water conservation because it's something that a lot of us gardeners are struggling with this year. Not much rain at all in the last 2 months. It's crazy. So this soaker hose that I've put in and used to use them back in the day saves water by up to about 70%. So it's nice to have this installed, really easy to attach to a pipe. But I'm also going to use, I think, a soaker hose system for all of the tomatoes in the Polycrub this year. Because last year there was a lot of watering with cans, and this year I'm going to put down soaker hoses, a bit of mulch, and it's going to be a lot more hands-off. And so that's, in an essence, is going to increase the value of the tomatoes. this in front of me brings me a lot of happiness because it is a forest of garlic, and actually it's almost, it's about a week or two away, although you could get away with it now, at the stage of green garlic. I'll be doing a video about that in the next week or so, but yeah, it's looking fantastic. We've got another garlic patch as well that is coming through really nice. I can't wait for all of these bulbs. These broad beans, a couple of weeks back, I felt a little sorry for because I put them out and then we got -5 degrees Celsius frosts that unfortunately killed off, I'd say, about 6 of them, which we've replanted with crimson flower broad beans, but the rest are Ratio and Eleanor. And what I've also done is I've put a very light, kind of centimeter thick mulch of grass clippings to help retain the moisture and also to bring some more fertility into the soil, you know, with all the nitrogen and everything. But it's just a really easy way of reducing the weeds, but also reducing the amount of water that these plants need. This is my little outdoor patch of elephant garlic that's coming on really well. I've interplanted it with radish, so that's producing already. And then this here is actually, I think in the last tour I called it cumin, I actually believe it's caraway. And the first of the flowers are starting to come through. So if I could get some homegrown dried caraway seeds to use in the kitchen, that would be something I've never managed to do before. And also just behind me, which has been mulched with wood chip, I'm actually going to be putting another bed there just to help further expand the amount of food that we can grow in this garden. This is a bed that I've mulched with RocketGro compost, and we've got some peas growing through. These also got hit by that serious frost and they were looking very unhappy, but they've found their feet again, and it can kind of show the resilience that nature has, which is pretty cool. We've got some spinach that's coming through, and then you can see that I've got a lot of brassicas that are flowering. These are kale around me. And I love it because they add so much height and structure to the garden when usually at this time of year it can be very bare and empty. And I'm letting them flower because, you know, just getting those nice pops of yellow is, it looks lovely. It's great for the bees. And also I can still harvest the leaves. I can harvest the flower stems and enjoy it as a food. But that is something I'll probably chop and drop in around 3 weeks. On the theme of chop and drop, I've actually been chopping and dropping some of this Swede, which I'm also letting flower just like the kale. And this is something that I'm trying out this year based on reading up a lot about jadam. So the idea of jadam is it's kind of a take on Korean natural farming, and it's about ultra low cost food production. And they talk a lot about how crop rotation is something you don't find in nature, and actually using crop residue is the best kind of fertility and fertilizer for the same crop. So I'm actually, not only have I chopped and dropped the Swede stalks and stems, where I'm going to be planting Swede again this upcoming growing season, I've also used the roots to create a jadam liquid fertilizer. This is a main amendment area for the garden, which is quickly expanding. I've actually found what I think potentially is a free alternative to buying tubs like this that almost anyone can source. So stay tuned for that. It's part of Project Leeks, which I introduced 2 videos ago. But this here is a Swede JLF, Jadam Liquid Fertilizer, which is basically a lot of plant matter, top it up with some water, and then a handful of either leaf molds or really good broken down compost to help inoculate it with biology. Leave it for a few weeks and then you dilute it and apply it to your plants. And this is something that I'll be sharing a lot more coming up in the channel. And I think it's something really fascinating for us to help reduce dependence on compost, but to also get better and tastier harvests using free resources. It almost always feels like it's summer here in a Polycrub, and everything's just is going nuts as it usually does. We've got all of the kind of first and second early potatoes starting to come through. This is a second round of them. The main round is probably just a few weeks away from being harvested. And then all of this is just growing absolute bonkers. this will all be replaced. We've got garlic that's going to be effectively green garlic, but all this will be replaced by cucumbers and tomatoes, etc. A lot more chop and drop happening, but it's just starting to turn into even more life and even more food. I think the craziest thing about the polycrub is that it hasn't seemed to be hit by frost at all over winter. This is physalis, and it's coming through, and it's doing a second flush. I thought it was an annual. It's kind of growing like a perennial, lots of green lantern shapes appearing. So much better than any kind of physalis that you get chucked on some random desserts in a pub. But the other thing I want to draw your attention to is this chervil here and this dill. We've also got lots of tomato plants just coming up. These are all self-sown. So you know how much I love to grow herbs and then let them flower. Where do you get all these free plants coming through? Another example is one of the areas actually in the main garden. We have a ton of dill and coriander coming through in like a little micro forest. I didn't have to sow those seeds. They've self-sown and I can transplant and move them about. So they're kind of plants, including tomatoes. You plant them once, let them drop some of the fruits or the seeds, and they'll come back every year. And I think that's so magical. One of the heroes in recent videos has been this purple sprouting broccoli patch. This is, I believe, Claret F1, but I lost the seed label, but I'm pretty confident it is. It's been so productive. It's kind of coming to the end now, so I'm gonna do one big final harvest, maybe let a few of them flower and potentially save a little bit of seed, but really pleased with how well this has done. Now, at the other end of this bed is actually some fennel that's grown from last year. I'm gonna let this flower because fennel flowers are beautiful. And when you have the tiny green seeds, they taste like little sweet bombs of aniseed. It's something everyone's gotta try. And then inside I've also got some peas growing. I've got some Oscar dwarf peas, which are really early peas, and some Cima Durapa, which I've mentioned in a recent video. That's actually getting quite close to harvesting. It's basically a sprouted turnip top, and it looks really cool, and I've been amazed at how quick it's growing. This bed here is more of a perennial focused bed. Behind me, it's kind of splayed and gone crazy, is a perennial kale, which I believe you can actually take cuttings of. It's a short-lived perennial. I'm gonna take cuttings of and see what happens. I've also got a little bit more asparagus coming through. And then towards the back end of the bed, I've got things like hostas, which are edible, especially if you have the shoots that grow through before the leaves uncurl. You can actually eat those and pan fry those. And then some herbs like chives and a lot of mint, because I love fresh mint tea and I need a lot of it. And yes, I'm growing it in a raised bed because I want lots of mint. If it ends up taking over the whole bed, well, maybe apart from the asparagus, I wouldn't care. To the right of me, I've got Oregon sugar snap peas, which is just starting to get underway, looking nice. This bed has been a bit of a challenge. The soil has been so hard, but we've actually been treating this with some JMS, Jadam Microbial Solution, which you basically make with sea salt, potatoes, water, and leaf mold, and we'll share that in another video. We've been applying it, and the soil quality now is, I mean, it's anecdotal, but it feels to me that it's starting to loosen up and look a lot richer. So I'm really pleased about that, because last year when we were trying to grow the squashes in here, it was basically like trying to get through brick. And also, what's really nice is that all of the flowers of the soft fruits, such as the red currants and the gooseberries, are starting to come out. They don't look anything special, but the bees do like them. And I just really like the effect of having soft fruit surrounding most of the garden. There's something so nice about that kind of perennial living hedge that's also edible structure to kind of enclose everything. And yeah, I'm excited for gooseberries. I'm oddly obsessed with them. And also so are squirrels. And I don't get that. These leeks here are leeks that I've actually transplanted for the purpose of them flowering. You know how obsessed I am with leek flowers, and so I've actually sacrificed some of the crops to actually let them grow for the flowers for the pollinators, but you can also use them in a variety of ways in cooking. I've also got a couple of rows of shallots. There's a lot more on the way that I'm going to be transplanting. And then we've also got some chard that I'm going to treat more as baby leaf, and some dill starting to come through. So in this small area here, there's so many different flavors and so much food that's going to come out from this little strip of this whole bed. And it can kind of show how much food you can get from a garden. I've been utilizing this cold frame a lot more this spring, mainly because there's so many seedlings that are starting. When they get nice and big, or if they're hardy, they can just come out and stay here. This is Asparagus tree cabbage, for example. These are the baby versions of these, and I think everyone needs to grow it. I've mentioned it a few times in videos, but I try and mention it as much as possible because I really do believe that every gardener needs to give Asparagus tree cabbage a grow. That was terrible. You may have noticed that I've put up a lot of my vertical structures. I haven't finished yet, but the reason why I like to do this, even a month or two before I plant out any of the beans, the sweet peas are out though, is because, I don't know, I just like coming into the garden and seeing them and knowing that these are going to be filled up. And I think visually as well, just putting in those structures whenever you have the time, it adds more interest to the garden, a little bit more vertical structure when there isn't much at this time of year. On this channel, I'm going to make sure that every month I do a garden tour just to share what's happening, give you some ideas and thoughts and some considerations. I know a lot of you are new to growing and are very keen to start enjoying harvest. So this video here is going to show you 10 crops that you can harvest in under 2 months from today.